We are delighted to welcome you all today to our annual Global Unity Dinner 2019. The institution, the monarchy, and our British values. Our lives have unfolded so differently, if this great nation had not welcomed us during the midst of war. So many lives in Sri Lanka were lost, both sides. And it's extremely sad as the consequences are still felt today. Sadly, I do not foresee a day where conflict is not raging in some part of the world. Unless, ladies and gentlemen, if we can change attitudes.
The message from our Honourable Theresa May, our Prime Minister. I'm delighted to send my best wishes to everyone attending the Global Unity Dinner. There can be no place in our society for the wild ideology that drives and incites hatred and fear. I welcome all effort to promote unity in our country and around the world.
Many people go to America to live the American dream. But many people like me and Selva and Sashi, my wife Rehu, we come to enjoy the British dream. I think British dream is much better than the American dream.
Selva is so much respectful to his family, his late father, his late mother. I was always touched whenever I came to this dinner to see the pictures of his father and grandmother. They're all here, which I think we should really learn from somebody like him and Tashini how to respect our parents, obviously, and parents, so be gentle.
Good evening, my lords, ladies and gentlemen. It falls to me to do something quite spectacularly special, that is to say, to be the first to announce the book launch of Selva's latest book, Thinking Into Character. Now, just to return the favour to Selva about special people, as he clearly indicated, direction. This is very clearly the top, you'll see. The number one book in this particular field. And I said to Selva, how is it that you managed in your this particular publication to achieve the number one book? He said, well, I haven't written number two yet. I tried, that's right. Many of you will know, I hope all of you actually know, that Selva is very committed to the education of young people and, of course, adults. And Selva, in this particular work, is trying to expand his own philosophy, education, and on the way that character develops. The title is Thinking Into Character. And he's attempting in this book very effectively to give guidance to individuals on how it's possible to develop, through education and learning, your own character to achieve the success you wish to achieve in life. And he asked me tonight, and I'm very privileged to do so, to conduct a little question and answer session around the book with Selva, to add a little bit of spice to the evening. So we're going to put the author on the spot here. If anybody's had a preview, you drop your own question into here if you want to do. Take it from the floor. It's a dodgy mic, this one. We'll take it from the floor. But I'm going to start really by saying, Selva, what inspired you particularly to put your thoughts down in this way? And what were the things that you were particularly thinking about in terms of thinking in your own character when you put this work together?
I think, George, it started with, when we started reading group, the purpose of it was the end of education character. And I always was seeking to see what that is. And we didn't really know when students come and ask us, all right, that's your ethos, it's written there, but how do I do it? So it is always a question in my mind ever since we started reading back in 2000. But then when I lost my dad in 2006, that's where things started to really question. There must be something out there, there's something different we need to be sort of knowing about rather than what we are seeing, what we are hearing, what we are learning. And that gave us the inquisitiveness, okay? And then that made me to, you know, I was fortunate enough to be Professor Clayton Christensen in Boston, you know, in Harvard. And that day, he dropped for me and he said, Selva, you really need to understand who you are and how the world works. If you want to create something, you really need to know the laws of nature. I didn't have the faintest clue what he was talking about. But that sort of stayed. That was then further validated by, I have got guests today from California, Bob Proctor and his son who is flown all the way from the States to be here with us. And Bob actually explained in a very, very simple manner. And that turned out to be, and just to finish off, Bob always said, so a lot of people write a lot of books for other professionals. Let's write a book to everyone. And I think that's what we try to do. And there is a book there on your chair. Love to get you used. Certainly not the product, but happy to learn, as always. That's what it says, George.
Okay, so I'll turn to you. You know, everybody here is thinking the so what question. So what can I take away from this book? You know, if you had to, you were pushed, and you're now about to be. What is the key message you want everybody here to take away with them about what this is about for you? Key message.
Yeah, the key message is pretty basic. It's about the basic law every force has its effect. And that's the physics, the reaction has its equal and opposite reaction. And if we expand that concept of cause and effect, and if you really want to change the results, and that is a effect, and the cause is your habits. You change your habits, your results will change. And sometimes what we tend to do is we want to change the results, and then we're trying to tinker the results, it wouldn't change. You've got to go and change the habits. And I think Stephen Covey did a huge amount of work on that, the 7 habits and the 8 habits and so on. So I think that's where Bob Proctor talks about, and Covey talks about that as principles, and we talk that as, in Bob's language, as laws of nature. So the one takeaway is, change habits will change results. That's the only way to change results.
Okay, I'll be a bit sort of confrontational on this. So, you know, I'm quite happy with my habits. I don't want to change my habits. What if I'm happy with what I do? What if I'm happy with what I've got? What will it do for me? Because sure. I think it will do things for you if you're happy with what you've got. So.
Sure. I think if we are happy with our habits, that's wonderful. And I think you don't necessarily need to change any habits. But if you feel that, because the book really starts with what is your purpose of your life, why you exist. And then when you're setting up your goals and your existence of it, and then you say, look, how do I achieve that? Maybe some of the habits may not be helping you to achieve what you're trying to achieve. And at that point you say, you know what, if I really want to change those results, achieve the habit, it is a choice. It is not, we are not dictating this. It is an idea. This is not the entire answer. It is perhaps some part of the answer. And you will discover it. It's an inside out education, George, as we talk about. It's incredibly internal. So it's not just what one outside in education. You know, you do an exam and you do various things and that's okay. But this is an internal journey, learning about your intuition, your will, your imagination, your reasoning, your memory. These are intellectual factors which you keep on working on. And that's where Mahatma Gandhi was able to take 200 million people behind him. How did he do that? Perhaps inside our education.
Read it, you need to read it, it's a must. It's one of those things if you're on a trip on an airline, wherever, take it with you. If not, it's a Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, take it easy type of read. It's available from me at a discount. I am operating a sales figure on this. I can look after it for you. I think Selva is prepared for a premium to sign it as well. So you're here, you've seen the book launch. It's the number one book in its field. Wait for book number 2. I'm sure it's in there and coming out. Selva, congratulations.
Please stand up for the grace. It's a Latin, it's very easy, very fast, very easy. It means whoever made the sky and the land, bless the food that we're going to receive. Latin is, quid fecit celum et totum, benedicat cibum et potum. Amen.
If you look around the room here, we have many different faces of what Britishness is, different people, different ways of thinking, different ways that they do things. Being British, we can also be English, Scottish, Welsh, Northern Irish, or indeed Sri Lankan, Indian, African, Polish, Italian, Pakistani, the list goes on. But the most important thing is that we're very inclusive in Britain, and that's one of the big British values that I think is most important.
So my fantasy becomes reality, and I must be what I must be and face tomorrow. So I continue to pretend that my life will never end.
And on tragedy, let me just say, and I'm going to be your shortest speaker tonight. I'll be your shortest speaker tonight because I'm only 6'7". And when I was at school myself, I wrote down the words of the Anglo-Irish poet William Butler Yeats, who said, "We cannot begin to live till we see or conceive of life as a tragedy." And I think that this is very, very wise and very true, because the good people in life, the winners, and in my experience of life, all the worthwhile people have had bad experiences. Every single person in this room has lost a parent, we've heard about that, lost a sibling, maybe lost a child, maybe lost possessions, lost cousins, lost things dear to us. And without exception, the heroes in life are the people who move on from that and who show courage, as Sri Lanka has shown after the appalling and tragic and awful events of these recent months.
We have learned that building a school is not enough. If you do not address the key issues that keep children in school, then it will not work. It's not sustainable. Currently, we are now providing access to our five-pillar sustainable model, which is called Sponsor a Village. And in Kenya and in Antri, India, we are currently providing access to education, clean water, nutritious food, and income training. Thank you.
I first met Selva 3 years ago in Canada, and I knew the moment I met him that he was someone very special. His calmness, his strength, his vision is not only changing lives, it will continue to change lives, and I am so grateful to be able to call him a friend and to have been invited to be a part of this.
This young girl, when we went there, she came up to me and she grabbed my hand and she held it for at least an hour. It was the most touching thing I have ever experienced. And she taught me about forgiveness. These girls are not only learning education, not learning, you know, knowledge. She was in a nursing program. She's not just learning nursing. They were learning leadership skills.
There are a lot of politicians ahead. They should do their bit. Unite all of us rather than dividing us. Education should teach tolerance, and we should learn to live in harmony.
My grandfather was working in a bank in India. But like many immigrants, when they come to, not just to the United Kingdom, to many countries across the world, they're doing the jobs that the indigenous population, or the jobs that are required to be done that nobody else wants to do. So when I look at it, and when my father looked at it, and as the generations, and when I always carry myself and what I'm going to do in my life, I look at, I sometimes think, could I have really done that? We've gone through those real sacrifices, get called those difficult names and, you know, all the prejudices and all the difficulties that they faced.
When you were born, how many of you were able to choose your color, your name, your parents, or your religion? And so why is it that as adults you have to go fighting and killing people to defend an identity which is artificial and which you had absolutely no choice whatsoever in selecting?
The whole of Sri Lanka, the whole of the world came together for a few moments, for a few days. And it didn't matter whether you were Tamil, whether you were Sinhalese, whether you were Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist, Christian, Jewish, no faith at all. For that moment, actually, there's just a collective solidarity for the people that had been targeted, for the families that had been targeted, because of course there were so many children involved being Easter Sunday services. The WhatsApp groups, the social media, these kind of things, actually were used for a power of good, because there were severe blood shortages in some of the hospitals across Sri Lanka. And for a while, the diaspora community here, the people in Sri Lanka, were actually putting out that call, please donate blood. And isn't it wonderful, therefore, although it's such a shame that it has to be in the face of such a tragedy, it's wonderful to see how people can come together.
Such a wonderful night for all of us. It is my first time to one of your dinners, and hopefully not the last.
So Desmond is one of the most substantial global entities that Sri Lanka has ever produced. Today we are ruled by politicians who have limited ethics, education and experience. We leave our future and the future of our children in their hands. We do this while we let the most accomplished Sri Lankans, like Sir Desmond, save the world.